say, you're the only one who can make me feel this way. My kind of lady, no better love could I embrace. No better heart, no other face. Can't quite compare with you. You came along and then you mend my broken dream. I was so down and then as foolish as it seemed. You gave me your affection. Yeah, baby, you came through.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Supertramp. Of course, the name is familiar. You know the songs, the gold albums, their huge concerts. Millions of fans around the world can hum the logical song, Goodbye Stranger, Dreamer, and many more. A truly internationally successful band whose music is heard everywhere, regardless of class, race, or language. For a whole decade, five fine gentlemen have made Supertramp a supergroup and maintained its high quality status. Five individuals who have chosen to remain discreet. Supertramp has attained stardom, and yet Rick, Roger, John, Bob and Dougie are still able to walk in the streets unrecognized and live their own life the way they want it. Tonight we shall wander with these five lads, three Englishmen, one Scot, one American, who have now elected California as their home. Through 10 years of hardship and success, 10 years of adventure, a whole decade of great music. There is always a beginning. Let's have a look at Supertramp in the making.
Yeah, it was an audition in London that I answered, an advertisement in a paper. And I arrived and it was the most crazy thing I'd ever been to. There were about 600 musicians applied for this one advertisement that said genuine opportunity. So I was one of many. But I happened to come at a time when the auditions had to stop, so myself and Rick had a chance to go down to the pub and have a drink, and we got to know each other and we liked each other. And that's probably a large reason why we decided to join up.
The beginning of it all was scads of tapes lying around in trunks, and a band who wasn't doing very well that needed support from a few more musicians. And basically it was about 15 pounds a week wage, if we could make that by doing gigs, and scrambling around trying to get the record company to allow us to make one more record, and going down to the record company with this new format of the band. And they thought we were coming down to ask them if we could get out of the contract. And in fact, we were coming down to ask if we could make one more record. And they allowed us to do that. And that was kind of essentially that.
Thank you. first time I met them was, I guess, 1972 in London. And I saw an advertisement in a newspaper for the group Supertramp. So I went along to a pub in Islington in London, and they were having an audition there. I guess I must have been about the 50th person they'd seen, because by that time they were completely demoralized and not really interested in auditioning people any longer. And the saxophone player at that time, Dave Winthrop, he'd already left. He was going to play pinball. Rick was asleep at the piano with a sleeping bag over his shoulders and a crash helmet from a motorcycle on his head. Why, I'll never know. And Roger and the drummer at that time, Kevin Curry, were trying to conduct the audition. So I played with him for about 2 minutes and left, feeling very sorry for him. And then some time later, Roger called me up and asked me to come down and stay with him and see how we got along. So I kind of went down to his house about 10, 11 years ago now. Still waiting for him to ask me to join the group. Yeah, when I first joined it, before Bob and John were in the band, we used to tramp up and down the motorway and play. We played quite a lot, but we didn't really make any money. Every once in a while we had to borrow money from Roger's mother to pay for the petrol to get to the concert. It just wound down over a year or so that I was in it, until the point where we were selling equipment just to exist, and we decided to pack it in. And that was the point where we recruited some new members, like John and Bob, and tried to give it a go again. Tried to get it right this time.
Supertramp, a strange name for a band bound for glory.
Well, it's named after a book called Autobiography of a Supertramp. We like the image of a supertramp because that's what we do. Basically, we're gypsies, but we go around the world in quite a super way. And so that's why we like the name back then.
Lady, you come across the water.
The first years, on the way to success, there were tough times and there were fun times.
Yeah, well, I think a lot of musicians have had tough times. We sometimes swap stories as to who slept in the weirdest place. I slept in an American Army barracks for 2 nights. I nearly got sent to Vietnam. They had an alert at 4 o'clock in the morning. Everybody got out of the place. I got under the bed. And it turned out to be a false alarm, I'm glad to say.
We had a lot of fun. We used to hide. I remember really harassing Chris DeBerg, who is in fact is a real good friend of ours. But we did some early tours with him and us in the early days. And we'd all have a little bit too much to drink, and we'd hide under his bed at night and scare him. We'd get his key and go into his room when he wasn't around, and wait for him to go to bed or sit down and play guitar or something. We'd come barreling out of the closets. So we had a lot of fun that way.
Well, there'd be many. Probably when Dougie got the audition as the bass player, when he came along for the audition as a bass player. We had already seen about 50 bass players, and what he saw when he came to the audition was Rick had a crash helmet on, and he was in a sleeping bag, and the sleeping bag was around him and his electric piano, so you couldn't see him at all. And the drummer was hiding in a corner, the sax player had gone out, and so I was about the only person left. And I think Doogie still wonders to this day why he got the job, but it was a crazy...
There was I don't know if I can tell you that one. It's hard to remember any particular single comical incidents. There's so many of them. There was one night, around that same time, when everything was going kind of wrong, and one of the guys in our organisation had a fight with one of the local gangs, so he went off to his room and settled down for the night. About 1 o'clock in the morning, he hears bang, 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 fire, fire, and he goes, no, these guys are out to get me. So he's there for about 5 minutes or so, and still banging on the door, fire, fire. So he finally creeps open and pulls the door apart, waiting for someone to throw water at him, and there's a fireman standing in the corridor, and there's smoke everywhere, and the hotel really was on fire.
Behind Supertramp's career, there stands an almost legendary and secret character, Sam, the Dutchman who helped make it happen.
Sam is a very, very lovable, eccentric, rich man who decided to, who believed in Rick and wanted to sponsor him enough to form a group around him. And so he was basically Rick's patron. And Supertramp's first manager. Give a little bit, give a little bit of your love to me. I'll give a little bit, I'll give a little bit of my love to you. There's so much that we need to share, so send a smile.
Sam lives in Switzerland. In the old band I was with, they fell on very hard times in Europe. We had no van, we had no equipment, our equipment was broken. And we knew this person that knew Sam, and he went and asked if he'd like to manage the band, and he did, which is a very big surprise to us. And of course, he has become a very interested person. He managed the band. He's managed the first two Supertramp albums, and he has become I don't know. He's had a special interest in me, you know, which is it's great. You know, he'll always turn up at the shows in Europe. And he takes an interest in my career, because obviously I was nothing when I met him, and I suppose it must be interesting to see somebody just come up like that. We'll be right back.
knew nothing about the rock industry, and that was where we went wrong. Because we didn't know anything, he didn't know anything, so together we spent a lot of money and didn't do anything. Didn't get much success out of it.
With success, the picture changes, and for each member of Supertramp, a new direction is set.
Well, it's rather sort of gratifying to the ego to be successful. It enables you to earn more money, which hopefully you can put back into your art, build studios, buy new instruments, experiment, and it gives you another important thing. That it gives you time. You don't have to go and screw nuts and bolts together. You can utilize that time by practicing.
Well, with success comes a lot of responsibility and a lot of power. And I think you have to use it wisely. It can really do you in. And I've seen all the traps, and I can feel all the traps that success and money and fame can take you. And I'm not interested in going that way, as a lot of other artists that I've seen have in the past. It's a real trap. It's very, very dangerous to get that much success and that much power and that much fame, because your ego goes crazy, or it has a tendency, and money is one of the most complicated things you can have in your life, believe me, a large amount of money.
Does everybody feel all right? All right, all right, all right. A lot of motion.
Investons pour la France. Et voilà. Investons pour Paris.
Hey!
Even though each and every member of the group is a master musician, they all acknowledge various influences and preferences.
Well, the saxophone's my main instrument, and it's saxophone players that have really influenced me, like Sonny Rollins and Cannonball Adderley, Charlie Parker, Wayne Shorter. Some of the great jazz figures, like Duke Ellington and Charlie Mingus, and Horace Silver, I like very much. And then...
combination. Going back to the early days, I think it's the same as everybody's, with Chuck Berry, Fats Domino, and the rhythm and blues period, all the black rhythm and blues guys.
Beatles, Traffic, that was my musical period, my musical youth.
Musicians, even stars, are human beings. When they are not making or playing music, they have other activities.
My hobbies at the moment are bicycle riding and a little bit of running and motorbikes. And I live in the hills just outside Los Angeles, so it's good. It's good twisty roads for motorbike, for fast motorbike riding, and good steep hills for bicycle riding. Build up the legs. I plan to cycle across the United States as soon as my schedule will allow it, maybe next year.
I work on the land. I love to be out making land beautiful, trimming trees, planting vegetables, hiking. I'm a nature freak.
Success brings money, and what do these boys do with it?
Well, a lot of my money has gone into this house, into the studio, and then we had a disaster here while we were building the studio where the three quarters of this house burned down. And the story is if you can break even with an insurance company, you're doing well. Well, we didn't quite break even, and in fact, it cost me quite a lot of money to put the house back to the way it was. And I've bought some property here and there. I've got a lot with nothing on it in Hawaii. Mainly, I've stashed most of it away into different deals that our financial advisor have cooked up for us. And I just don't want to end up sitting on the curb someplace wishing I still had some of the money that I had generated when I was younger, you know. So I put most of my money away. And I bought a little place at the beach so I can go surfing conveniently and stuff like that. I'm very careful with my cash.
Take a look at my girlfriend. She's the only one I got. Not much of a girlfriend. I never seem to get along. Take a jumbo across the water. Like to see America. See the girls in California. I'm hoping it's going to come true. But there's not a lot I can do. Well, could we have Christmas for breakfast? Mommy dear, mommy dear. They gotta have them in Texas, cause everyone's a millionaire. I'm a winner, I'm a sinner. Do you want my autograph? Well, I'm a loser, oh, what a joker. I'm paying my jokes upon you. Well, there's nothing better to do.
Supertramp has been based in California for 7 years now. How's America changed them?
Well, I'm very happy that I was brought up in England and can retain the good side of the English. But now I'm in America, I can let go of a lot of the stuff I don't like about the English character. The good thing about America is that you can be yourself, you can be whoever you want to be, because there's not the centuries of tradition and class systems and just the culture of Europe that often holds you back and you get fixed in the mold. Especially in California, there are more eccentrics and freaks in California who are just doing their own thing, and people just don't bother you. It's an amazing place for that. I'm in California, not in America. California really is what does it for me. I found that I could be myself, who I wanted to be, more here than I could in England. And for now, I like that.
California! Hello!
Los Angeles is very plastic, yeah. But that's a generalization. Within Los Angeles, there are some incredible people, too. Los Angeles isn't a very healthy place mentally or physically or spiritually to live. But there are other places in California. Where I live now is an incredible place, and there are some incredible people there with some incredible ideas, new ideas, that I find very stimulating. New visions of in all fields of life, in music, in healing, in new forms of energy, in new forms of living together, just breaking through old traditions. And California is just great for that.
Very finely put, Roger. Two great musical figures have disappeared in the early 80s, Bob Marley and John Lennon. What do they feel about these two great talents?
I look to John Lennon as a model of an artist who was true to himself and true to his art and really tried to give everything he could back to the world in every way he could. And I look to him as my model, if you like. If he was writing his script for his life, he could see that he could probably do more good for the world by dying that way than if he'd lived. Because he was a 60s hero. We need 80s heroes now. John Lennon could have been one, but I believe he did an incredible amount of good by dying for us.
Not so much for Bob Marley, because I wasn't really aware of that much of his work, but I realized who he was. And it's just sad, you know, in that case, to be ill and at such a young age, you know, and he was really cracking away in his career and stuff. I mean, it's terrible news, you know. With John Lennon, I mean, that really hit me, because I'm really from that generation where the Beatles really hit our generation, you know. And I just thought, what a terrible thing, you know. I mean, just to imagine somebody walking up and ripping John Lennon's chest away is just an awful thing.
Okay. We will now try to learn what makes a group successful and what are the magic ingredients.
It would take a songwriter like Rick and a saxophone player like John and probably a bass player kind of like Doogie. And I kind of like the way I play myself. And a real fiery guitar player, somebody who can really punch it out there. Just the one guitar, though, you know, I don't want two. Just want the one guitar player who can really pop it out there.
I've got a message for you today. To tell you that you are my kind of lady. I'm not the same since I met you. All of my dreams had fallen.
People with a lot of patience, a lot of understanding, yeah. You gotta just have a lot of give and take and a lot of compromise to get along with five different, you know, if there's five people who are all fairly creative and all have pretty solid ideas about how they would like things to be, it takes a lot of give and take for that to balance. It is like a big marriage, only you're married to four other people instead of one. Is that illegal?
I really enjoyed talking to you on the boat, Dougie. Let's hope maybe next time we can do it on dry land.
Hard times are always the best. They always end up as being the best. People think that, I think we're going through the hardest times now. I think it's when success, when an artist becomes successful is when it's the hardest. Back then when what we thought were hard, times were hard, when we were really struggling, what happens is the band really came together, and because it was survival.
in the interest of survival. Now, when we have all the success and the money that comes with success, it's very difficult to maintain that. And that's why most groups split up when they achieve success. One of the hardest things.
Why?
Because it's a major, major challenge. We haven't really seen each other for 3 years, and we wanted to tour, but it's the first time we've played these size of venues, and there's a lot of organization, a lot at stake.
After 10 years of a musical marriage, Roger Hodgson announced his decision to leave the group and pursue a solo career.
Basically, during the process, during the last 3 years, we have grown a lot, all of us, individually. And I've grown away from where the rest of the band have been. I've actually moved 500 miles away from where the rest of the band live, which is very difficult to feel like you're in a group. What I'm getting into where I live is totally different to what the rest of the band in Los Angeles are getting into. And that, coupled with the fact that the last album, Famous Last Words, was not a fulfilling project for all of us, for any of us. It didn't turn out to where we were happy with it. Far from it, in fact. And I know that my music can be much better expressed if I'm not with Supertramp. I have 64 songs waiting to go on record. If I have to wait for Supertramp to record an album every 3 years and be able to put 5 songs on it, I'm never going to get unconstipated musically. So I don't see this as the end. I really see this as, you know, in a marriage, sometimes when you get divorced, you can become friends again. And that's when you want to spend time together. But when you're married, you just want to get away from each other. Well, that's kind of the feeling that existed in Supertramp, you know. Rick and I felt we were strangling each other. And now we're closer than ever. Now we've taken this decision. Rick and I are unbelievably close. It's incredible. So I can see working with him and staying friends with him and making music with him. And John's going to be on my album. I'm always going to use John, probably, because he's my favorite sax player in the world. So I think it's very, very good that we're all feeling good about it, because in a way it was it was the uncertainty of everything before this decision was taken that was making everything feel bad. And with this tour, we're just really going out to have a good time and make it a really last bang.
Early morning yesterday, I was up before the dawn. Enjoyed my stay, but I must be moving on. Like a king without a castle, like a queen without a throne, I'm a early morning lover, and I must be moving on. Yeah. Now I believe in what you say is the undisputed truth.
Your answers are always very so succinct and to the point. It is a pleasure talking to you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Jody.
Some they will and some they won't. Some it's just as well. You can laugh at my behavior, that'll never bother me. Say the devil is my savior, but I don't pay no heed. And I will go out shining, you're shining like brand new. I'll never look behind you.
Well, thank you very much, Bob. It's been very nice talking with you. Thank you very much, Roger. You really are an incredible talent, John. I must say, I really admire your playing over the years. It's been an inspiration to me and my son and their sons too. Well, that concludes our evening with Supertramp. Thank you. Let's wish the boys another 10 years of continued success. Cheers. Thank you very much for your attention.
Well, thank goodness that's over.